H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys supports 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus. One-time pay, lifetime access to live classes and videos. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For free demo class, visit h2kinfosys.com.
Welcome to another video of H2K Infosys. In this particular video, we are going to see the topic of Reflection API. Reflection API is specifically used for the purpose of getting information about a class. As far as the properties of the class are concerned, the properties of the class can be your constructors, the variables, and the methods. So if you want to get information about what is the class name or what are the different constructors present along with their parameter types, what are the access specifier used in the constructor, what is the constructor name, or if you want to get an information about the what are the global variables present, what type of global variables it is, what is the access modifiers or the access specifier used with the global variables. So we can use the Reflection API for that. A Reflection API can be also used to get the information about the methods present in the class. What is the name of the method? What are the parameter types of the method? What are the overloading methods present? And what are the return types of the methods? What are the access specifier used in the method? So all this information will be possible by using the Reflection API. So let us go ahead and understand the certain theoretical parts of your Reflection API by itself. So Reflection is the process of analyzing the capabilities of a class at runtime. So the at runtime, if you want to get an information about the class, or if you want to analyze the capabilities of the class at runtime, we can use the Reflection API. Generally, what do you mean by analyzing? Analyzing means the details about the class, which includes the methods in the class, the variables of the class, the constructors present in the class, the interface that the class is implementing, or the methods that are coming from the interface. Even the methods that are implemented from the superclass, that is the object class, can also be shown by using the Reflection API. Now, to gather all the above details that is discussed in point number 2, we use Reflection API by itself. Reflection API is not a project development but used for product development. So it is not to be used. This particular API is not of any importance as far as project development is concerned. For service-oriented companies or people or companies rather who are servicing the clients, you would not need the Reflection API until and unless companies are involved into your product development as a whole. So, for example, I want to make a compiler in Java, or I want to develop a Java virtual machine, my own Java virtual machine, or I want to design a server or create and design a framework or design a tool. We can use Reflection API. Now, if you look at the general understanding of a JVM, Java Virtual Machine, which comes with your JRE and JDK, the Java Virtual Machines understands what are the classes present in the package, what is the package name, what are the access modifiers that can be used with classes, what are the different methods present in the class, what are their access specifiers, what is the return type, is it static or non-static method, similarly what are the kind of constructor present in that particular class, what are the name of the constructor, what are the access specifiers of the constructors, what are the parameters of the constructor. Similarly, it also understands what are the variables present in the classes, what are their return, what are their data types, and what are their access specifiers per se. So this is known by the compiler present in the Java Virtual Machine. So if we write down or we implement a bad code, for example, if we try to use a private variable outside of the class in which it is created, immediately the compiler is going to show you a syntax error that it is not visible. So let's say there's class A and class B. In class A, you've created a private variable, global variable, and you're trying to call that private global variable inside class B by creating an object of class A inside class B. Immediately, we'll get a syntax restricting that variable is not visible. And this is coming because private variables can be used only in the class in which it is created. How would a compiler know that private variables would have to be used in the class in which it is created? It is because of the reflection API present inside the compiler. That is what I am trying to say. Similarly, how would a compiler present in JVM know that an outer class should be public, whereas an inner class can be private? It knows because these rules of a class or a method or a constructor or a variable is defined in the compiler. So if we write down a code which is an invalid code, immediately the compiler is going to show you syntax error. And that is done by the compiler because there is a reflection API implemented inside the compiler of your JVM. So let us understand a particular example out here. For example, we have a class A, which is a private class. Now, an outer class cannot be a private class. An outer class can be public, abstract, or final. But an inner class can be a private class. Inner class is a class within the outer class. So this is a private class called A. Okay. And if you look at this particular example, as far as the commenting concern, an outer class, as we have discussed, cannot have a private declaration. Inner class can have private declaration. A class can be declared as public and default. It cannot have private or protected access specifier. That means an outer class cannot be declared as private and protected. It can be declared as public, default, and abstract. So this is a typical example of an inner class called private, which is present inside an outer class. An outer class can be public, abstract, or final. Inner class can be private or protected. So this is a rule in Java language. Now, how does the compiler know this particular rule? The compiler knows this particular rule because there's a reflection API present inside the compiler of your JVM out there. Now, if you look at this particular class, the compiler will read the class according to the class rules. And the class rule says that you can have a public or abstract or a final access modifiers used with the outer class. So can have public, default, and abstract to access modifiers in outer class, but will not allow private and protected access modifier for outer class. But yes, an inner class can be private or protected. Now, this rule is analyzed by the compiler present in the JVM. And after the analysis, it will throw out a syntax error if we are creating an outer class with a private modifier or a protected access modifier. An outer class can only be public, abstract, and final. So based on the rule defined by reflection API, okay, this rule of the outer class and inner class will be analyzed by the compiler present in JVM. And based on the rule, the syntax error will be thrown out by the compiler. And how does the compiler know the rule? Because it is defined in the reflection API present inside the compiler. So this rule is analyzed by the reflection API present in the compiler, and it shows an error: modifier private, not allowed. Similarly, rules for methods in the class or constructors in the class or interfaces inherited by the class or superclasses extended by the class are also present, and their access modifier are also checked by reflection API present in the compiler by itself. Now, reflection API is part of reflect package, and the reflect package provides a lot of classes for performing the reflection API. The classes present in this reflect package are the following. So these are the classes present in the reflection API. There's a class called class by itself. There's a class present in reflect package which is called as class. This is considered as the base class to perform reflection API. So you need to create this class called class. So there is a class by the name of class only, and this is considered as a base class in reflection API. So if we want to use reflection API, we have to create a class called class. So it's used to gather complete metadata of the particular class. So this class called class is basically used to actually gather complete information about the metadata present in a particular class. There's another class called the field. The field class gives complete declarative information of a particular variable. That means it gives complete metadata information of a particular variable, like access specifiers or modifiers used in the variable, the data types of the variable, the values of the variable, and the name of the variable. Similarly, there is another class called the method class in the reflection API. The method class gives complete declarative information about the method. That is, what is the metadata pertaining to that particular method? Metadata precisely gives you information about the method's name, the metadata like your access modifiers present in the methods, the return types of the methods, the parameters used in the methods, and any exceptions that is thrown by that particular method. Similarly, there's another class called the constructor class. It basically gathers information about the constructors present in the particular class. The constructor information can be in terms of metadata. Metadata can be the name of the constructor, the access modifier used in the constructor, and the parameter types present in the constructor. The next class present in the reflection package is your modifier class, and this gives complete metadata information about the access modifiers that are being used with different variables or methods or with your constructors. Now, this is a typical example of a class created. So there's a class called employee, which implements these two interfaces called the serializable interface and the clonable interface, and it has three variables: a public integer e number variable, a public static string e name variable, a public final string e address variable. And it has two constructors: public employee. We know that constructor takes the name of the class file. This is a public employee, no argument constructor, and this is another constructor called public employee, which has arguments like integer e number, string e name, and string e address. Similarly, this class has two methods too. One is a public void add, which has parameters like your e number, e name, and e address, having parameter types of integer, string, and string respectively. And it has another method called the public void search method, and the parameter type is your integer, and the variable is e number. So this is the class created called the employee class, which has these number of constructors, these number of variables, and these number of methods. Now, how does a reflection API store this information as a metadata information inside it? That is what we are going to see in the next slide. So this is the slide which looks like. And if you see that, the class object created for employee class referred by CL. Okay. So this is the class object. So we know that when we want to use a reflection API, we have to create an object of the class called class. So class object created for the employee class referred by CL. The data stored are, so what are the data stored in this class object? The data stored are is the name of the class, that is employee, the superclass managed by another class object called the object class, and this is the object class which looks like. So the object class is nothing but the class created to store information about the superclass, which is used in the class called employee. Now, the object class metadata stored is in the form of objects. Similarly, other parts of the data stored in the class object created for the employee class are your interface list. And this interface list is managed by a class array. So if you look at this class array, it will contain at the 0th index class object of the serializable and the class object of the clonable. Now if you see that this particular class employee had implemented two different interfaces, that is serializable and clonable. Oh, and these information, metadata information about the interfaces that this class employee is implementing is stored in a class array. The 0th index will have the class object of serializable. First index will have the class object of the clonable interface. Similarly, this object, the data stored in the class object will also have information about the fields. The fields are managed by the field array, and when you look at the field array, the 0th index will have field object containing the e number metadata. The first index will have field object containing the e name metadata, and the second index will have field objects pertaining to your e address metadata. That means these are nothing but variables declared in the employee class, and these are stored in the field array. Similarly, this data will also store the metadata information about the constructors, and the metadata information about the constructors is managed by the constructor array. And if you look at the constructor array, there are two constructors defined in the employee class. The zeroth index will have the object where employee constructor metadata is stored, and the first index will have constructor object where employee constructor metadata will be stored. There are two constructors out here. One is a no argument constructor, which will be stored in index number 0, and there is an argument based constructor, that is integer e number and a string e name and a string e address, which will be stored in the index number 1. So this constructor array will store information or the metadata information about the constructors present in this class called the employee class. The last information stored in the class object of the employee class will be the method, and this method's metadata information is managed by the method array. So we look at the method array out here. There are two probably methods, the add method and the search method. Okay, the first index, that is the zeroth index will show method object where the add method metadata will be stored. The first index will store the method object where search method metadata will be stored. There are two methods in this particular class called the employee class. One is the add method, one is the search method. So the add method metadata information will be stored in index number 0 of the method array, and the search method metadata information will be stored in the first index of the method array. So this is how it is stored, and this CL represents the reference variable of the employee class. This is how Reflection API stores information about a particular class. Now, in order to get information about methods, constructors, variables, etc., we need to create the base class. The base class is nothing but a class created for the class for the class called class. So there is a class by the name of class only in Reflection API. So that the object of the class should need to be created in order to get information, or in order to use rather the Reflection API. So this is how, there are three ways in which you can create object of the class called class. So class dot for name, and the employee is nothing but the name of the class. So this class dot for name method. So this is one of the ways to create the base class. The base class is created for the class called class, and you have to use the for name method. The for name method is a method of the class called class, and the string will be nothing but the class name out here. So class C is equal to class dot for name, and then the name of the class for which you are creating the base class. This is creation of the base class. This base class is very important so that we can use the Reflection API. So here we are able to get class object referred by C. FontName method is a static method of the class called class. Functionality of FontName method is to search for employee class file at current location at Java predefined library and location referred by the class path environment variables. If not found, the JVN will throw a class not found exception. This is one way of creating the base class. The another way of creating a base class is using the get class method. So you create an object of the class. So the, right now the class is the employee class. So you create an object of it and then use the get class method. Okay, and reference it with the reference variable of the employee class. So e dot get class. Okay, and put it equal to the class called class out here. The get class method is present in the object class, that is in the super class. Object is considered as the super class, which is a super class, and employee class by default extends super class. Obviously, any class that you create will extend the super class or the object class. And in Java, object is considered as a super class. So when you create an object of the employee class, what you are trying to do is that with the reference variable of the employee class, you are calling the get class method. And this get class method is a method of the super class, or considered and super class in Java is nothing but the object class. And since your employee object that you have created will extend the super object by itself, so you can use the get class method of the super class inside the object of the employee class. And the return type of get class method will be equal to the class called class, which is a class present in your Reflection API. This is a second way to create the base class in order to use the Reflection API. The third way is by using the dot class. So you have the employee class, the employee dot class, and reference it with the variable c of the class called class. This is third way. So class with the lowercase c is a static and final variable. When compiled, attaches the class variable and represents the class object referenced by c out here. So this is the third way to create the base class. Once we create the base class, we can actually get information about a particular class using the reflection API. So after getting the class object, we need to get details about the class. How do you get details? For example, we can use the getName method. The getName method will give you the name of the class. And it's a public method by itself with the return type of string. That this will give you the name of the class. Okay, similarly, we can use in order to get a superclass details. So as we have seen that any class we create will automatically inherit or extend the superclass called object. So if you want to get the superclass details, we have to use this particular method called the getSuperclass method. And the return is a class by itself, and it's a public class. Similarly, if we want to implement, to get all implemented interface details in the form of class array. So if you want to understand what are the interfaces used by the employee class or by any class, so we should use the getInterface method. The return type is a class array. You can see that it's a public class by itself. Similarly, if you want to get access to the access modifiers used in the class, we need to use a two-step procedure. The first step will involve that you use the getModifiers method with the return type of integer. Okay, and this will be passed into your public static string to string integer method. So this will give you the information about the access modifiers used in that particular class.